Good morning, everyone. Hello. I'm Nicola. I'm one of Equity's counsellors. I'm a generalist counsellor. And I've stepped in last minute to chair this panel discussion on our equality campaign, our Play Fair campaign. Abiola got a job, yay for Abiola, so I've stepped in for her. So today we're going to be discussing class action, which is about who gets in and gets on in the creative industries. So we'll go along and introduce everyone in the panel. But before we do, can I just have a rough show of hands? Like, who's here? Who's a performer? Have we got a lot of equity members? Have we got any journalists here? No. Have we got people that make theatre? Directors, practitioners, owners? Great. That's great, just so I know who's in the room. So first of all, I'm Nicola. I'm an actor musician, mainly by trade. I went to Arts Ed, did musical theatre, so mainly working in the musical theatre industry. I would definitely consider myself a working class actor. My dad was a carpenter, my mum was a dance teacher. Luckily for me though, my little brother was in a bunch of shows as a kid, so I had access to cheap theatre tickets, so I was going to see him in shows quite a bit. And through that, that's kind of where my love of theatre came from. I also live in Zone 6 within London, which I think is a big part of one of the barriers to being a working class actor. I can always jump on a tube. I don't have to pay millions of pounds to come down from Manchester. I can get into London to audition quite easily. And every time I finish a job regionally, I can quite easily just crash at my mum's until I sort my life out again. So I do consider that I've got my own privileges, but I definitely consider myself a working class actor as well. So I'm just going to hand over to the panel. Shall we start down the end with Dave?
Yeah, sure. I'm Dr. Dave O'Brien. I work up at the University of Edinburgh. And basically, I do lots of work about creative industries and creative economy, and I've looked specifically at actors in terms of things like pay, what the composition of the acting workforce is, and have a kind of pretty depressing story to tell you all, basically.
So we'll just introduce everyone first, and then we'll go back and get everyone to do kind of like 5 minutes on what their insights and what they've think we can do about it as well. So Tom?
I'm Tom Stocks. I'm an actor and I also run the Actor Awareness Campaign, which fights for quality, diversity and working class talent in the industry. I hope I'm kind of the voice for the working class actors because I'm going through it myself at the moment. That's it really, just,
yeah.
Emmanuel? My name's Emmanuel. I'm Equity's industrial organiser for low and no pay. So I cover any of our members who are working in low-budget productions on non-equity contracts and also run the union's campaign to try and tackle that work. So I'll tell you a bit more about that shortly.
I'm Tracy Brabin, the MP for Battley and Spen. I've been an actor for 30 years and a writer for 15 years. I've written on all sorts of shows, Hollyoaks, Shameless, Tracy Beaker. Recently, I became an MP. Last Saturday I was an MP for 100 days, so I'm a brand new MP with a unique skill set, so I'm hoping to bring that skill set to my constituency and to the House of Parliament.
Stephen will be joining us shortly as well. He's just running a little bit late, so when he comes in I'll introduce him quickly as well. So Dave, do you want to tell us a bit about the work you've been doing and the research and the depressing stories?
Yeah, I mean I'll start with some numbers. About a year ago, myself, Simon Friedman, who's at the LSE, and Daniel Morrison, who's now working over in America, published a paper looking at the sort of distribution by social class of who works in the acting industry. And we use this thing called the Labour Force Survey, which is the Office for National Statistics picture of the entire British economy seen through its workers. And what we found is about 50% of people working as actors, according to the Labour Force Survey, are from what we might think of as kind of middle class or affluent professional or managerial social origins. This is a big kind of over-representation of this social group in two ways. It's an over-representation in terms of the industry, like half of the industry is posh, basically is the kind of like, I guess, the sort of Daily Mirror headline. And this compares to only 16% from what we might think of as kind of working class social origins. So there's an overrepresentation in terms of the industry, but also it compares quite badly to the picture of British society that we have. About 29% of British society are from this kind of middle class section of society, but they make up 50% of the acting industry. Put my numbers away now. What we did following this was try to probe why this might be, and we've got a couple of ideas about this. We use a metaphor from science studies called the leaky pipeline. We think about the kind of moments where people from working class origins might kind of drop out, the various sort of hurdles they have to overcome. And this starts, we think, at quite a young age, about the kind of possibility of being an actor. That people from working class social origins don't really think being an actor is a kind of career for them, partially because of its precariousness, the kind of risks around being an actor, but also because of things like not having the same levels of exposure to things like drama in school or going to theatre or stuff like this. Then the kind of hurdles of, say, getting into drama school. What we found in our field work, we did field work with 47 actors, and we've just finished some more field work across the creative industries more broadly, is that drama schools have a lot of assumptions about who should be an actor, about what the kind of right sort of person is to be an actor. And these assumptions are to do with gender, ethnicity, and social class. And in class terms, it's that kind of sense of like, well, maybe if you're working class, it's not the right kind of environment for you. And working class people, we found, even when they get into the good drama schools, have quite a rough time because they sort of feel like it's not the space for them, it's not for sort of people like us, is the kind of thing they tell us. Then when they get to leave and try and get an agent, they're confronted with similar, I guess, assumptions or prejudices that they found in their entrance to drama school. So, you know, these are kind of hurdles that they're trying to get over. Then when they're trying to get work, they're confronted with a system that is really not working class at all. So I told you about actors, but when you look at people who, say, work in television, who are writers, directors, the percentages get much worse, actually, in terms of class origin, and actually in terms of whiteness and maleness as well. So, for example, I can give you a couple of examples. People telling us that, you know, they can get good roles as, say, playing coppers if they're sort of 6 foot tall, working class guys, but they're highly unlikely to be considered appropriate for, say, playing Hamlet. For working class women, they'll be offered, I guess, you know, lots of the roles you were offered, but they won't be offered kind of the lead in Downton or something like this. In many ways, this is a struggle that's faced by all actors. You know, the kind of the encounter with the typecast is not something that's unique to working class origin actors, but they are limited by the kinds of roles that they get offered. And I guess the burden of not being able to resist very problematic assumptions that a largely middle class system has about who the working class are and what they should be. One of my favourite quotes is from a black northeast actor who told us that she'd been offered hundreds of parts as nurses because that was the assumption of what a black working class woman was if she was from the northeast of England, but she'd never read for the role of a doctor. Because somehow it was assumed that her social group was not the kind, the type that would become doctors. Then on top of this, there's loads of other stuff like having to work in London. London's very expensive. You know, the kind of precariousness of many of our working class origin actors told us about working 2 or 3 jobs, maybe in a cafe, versus their more affluent origin people who maybe have flats bought for them in London by their family. They can turn up and go kind of straight off book for an audition, whereas someone who doesn't have the same financial resources struggles to prepare and this kind of thing. So there's a range of kind of barriers that explain this, I guess, this kind of uneven distribution of who works as actors according to the ONS.
Brilliant, thank you. I'll come back to you in a bit about what you think we might be able to do about
that.
And we'll be opening the floor to questions and answers as well. So if you can think of your questions and write them down as we go along, I'll open it up to the floor in a minute. So Tom, do you want to tell us a bit about the actual awareness campaign and your background and your barriers? And
yeah, sure. I mean, the whole reason I started actual awareness is because I just finished uni, wanted to kind of go to drama school to kind of get the drama school training. purely because I wanted to obviously get the showcase, get the agent. You think that's the easiest way in that sort of aspect. It's always, drama schools always pick and go, that final showcase, you'll get an agent there, blah, 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 but it's not as easy as that. So in terms of when I finished uni, I got into East 15, forgot basically about how difficult it is about government funding, how to raise 12 grand for that year. Worked as a chef, 50 hours a week, minimum wage, tried to save up, went to Edinburgh, put my own show on there, but obviously that takes out the drama school fund. That was a grand gone down the drain as well. But obviously just try and top it up as best you can. And for 2 years, I deferred my place. And it got to Christmas and I just said, I'm chasing a dream I can't really afford. So I got quite pissed off. So I started to kind of write blogs, write everything to kind of bring these kind of issues to the forefront. And people going, well, do something about it. So that's why I created the campaign, to kind of be a voice for other people who I knew were in the same boat as me. So from there, we've kind of, I think, because I think it's just so hard. If you haven't gone to drama schools, try and get in this industry. If you've not got the drama school training, you hardly get into an audition room. And half, apart from that, you don't get agents seeing you without the showreel, without the headshots and all that sort of stuff. So it's so hard if you haven't had the training to go through that sort of thing. So that's what the campaign's about, to give voice to those sort of people. So I started the Scratch Nights up. Now we've just joined forces with Spotlight because it was coming out of my pocket and I only work in a call centre. So paying for that sort of campaign is really hard. So Spotlight, I pitched it to them and they said, yeah, we want to do that sort of stuff. And they know, they full well know that they're an ivory tower. They know that we have to pay £150 a year. And I want to be get into that system to change that. So I want to try and they said it for years now. Oh yeah, we'll do monthly payments. Have you? You said that 4 years ago. So I want to try and get in there to try and push that forward. And obviously Spotlight are now offering a bit of funding as well. And we pay the actors, we pay the directors, pay the writers to try and get those professional credits down. And we set themes. So I set, we've done working class theme, we've done gender, we've done race, we've done mental health. And we set those to try and tackle the minorities in the industry that don't normally get the voices in terms of scripts. So try and give people the chance to not get typecast and play roles that they want to play, and get new writing on the board. Because it's not, when you talk about working class actors, well, there's actually not any working class parts out there, apart from the stereotypical sort of things. So it's giving people the opportunity to kind of do that. And even for us, that's what the Actor Awareness Campaign we're kind of doing. We've just touched down in Manchester last week, which I think is another massive problem. Everything's London-centric. You look at Manchester, you look at Liverpool, you look at Newcastle, there's hardly anything up there for them in terms of that. So we're trying to open up there as well. And then you look at everything else, like the drama school, the audition fees, you look at obviously like a Spotlight, you look at all that. The costs, you're up against it before you even started with the money. So if you haven't got the money, if you haven't got a stable financial at home for your parents to kind of help out, It's very, very hard, and it is. And especially living in London as well, you're paying £900 for a room. It's ridiculous. So hopefully I can help, I guess. I'll stop now because I'll get angry.
Okay, Emmanuel works for Equity. He's the Low and No Pay organiser. So I think you're going to link a little bit about the Low and No Pay campaign to and how that affects working class.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think it's really, really important, actually, that we're having this chance to discuss this, because I've been working on this issue of low and no pay for nearly 3 years now, and it's felt to me incredibly important that we make the link. I mean, you've heard about the figures. We have some figures as well. So, you know, we kind of intuitively knew there is a problem in the industry. Our members have been telling that for a long time, but now we have some evidence. That's incredibly important. You've heard about this idea that there's I really like the leaky pipeline. You know, there are these barriers that come up, and you know, I've talked with Tom about some of them, to do with drama school, how you get into drama school that you want to, that you think is, you know. But I'm talking about, or coming at it from the point of view of what happens after that point. So once you go into the world of work, the picture can be quite bleak, and the culture and the prevalence of low and no pay work, I think, is one of those very, very serious cracks in the pipeline. I think this is a point where a lot of very good people drop out of the industry people who have the talent and the ability to get into drama schools. We see it in our figures. We have student members who join while they're studying, who never go on to have careers in the industry. What's happening to those individuals? We have some figures of our own. You know, we ask our members, and at our last pay survey, 47% of equity members were reporting earnings of less than £5,000 a year from their work in the industry. Half our members said they'd worked for free that year in the 12 months preceding. So if half our members are doing it in 1 year, almost everybody is at some point. So we think there really is a serious problem here. Everyone else's figures back this up. SALT, the Society of London Theatres, looked at the theatre scene in particular, so in fringe theatre in 2013, 80% of fringe actors in London worked for nothing or for less than the national minimum wage, 80%. So only one in five were being paid a legal wage for their work. Bear in mind, 60% of all theatre is fringe theatre, and we're talking about a huge volume of work here. I mean, you know, the list is endless. The New Directors Association, SDUK, looked at the picture for directors, exactly the same result. Half of their members earning less than £6,000 a year. Casting Call Pro do the same survey there. It's 85% of their subscribers less than £5,000 a year. And if you look at the work that is advertised on Casting Call Pro or its more expensive cousin Spotlight, you will see these vast amounts of unpaid work on profit shares in theatre, which, you know, as from my experience of talking to about 1,500 of our members who work in this area, has become a dirty word, really. I mean, most of you will take profit shares expecting no pay. To expenses only work, you know, full scale shows running for 3 weeks with 3 week full time rehearsal period where you'll get paid £250 all in, right? And I mean, that's not the worst, you know. Nicola flagged up today a company that's asking the performers to, in fact, buy the tickets up front and then sell them, so buying the house. It's not the first time we've heard of that. Look, what we're dealing with is a very, very bad labour market position. You know, the supply of actors into the industry, and we talk about focused on actors, but, you know, I think this is true for all our members working in these industries, is very, very big compared to the amount of work there. So you see this downward pressure on wages, and, you know, if it keeps going down, you actually go beyond zero to where you're expected to pay to perform. That's what that sort of arrangement is. So a very serious problem, and I'm just here to tell you what Equity believes about this, what our position is, and what we're doing to try and fix it. And to be honest, I can go on about this stuff for hours and hours, so I'm going to control myself, and as a result, only give you quite a kind of brief explanation of what we're doing. But then when we have questions and so on, if you want to hear more about, for example, what you can each do to try and make things better, that sort of stuff, we can go into it. I mean, the first thing is big principles. Equity is absolutely ideologically committed to tackling discrimination. I mean, I brought a copy of our rule book because I'm sure you've all read it. I mean, it's a very important document. And flicking through it, you get, I'm sure you know this, but rule 3.1.1.8, yeah. To oppose actively all forms of harassment, prejudice, and unfair discrimination. And then it lists some of the categories of characteristic that you might be discriminated on, and classes in there. So, you know, it's part of our rules. It's absolutely at the core of what equity stands for, to have an industry that's open on the basis of your ability and your merit, you know, your talent, hard work. It's always going to be difficult, but not where you come from or what your family do. So what can you do about all of this? Because when I started the job, everyone said that's just the way it is. You know, it can't change. That's how the industry is set up. Well, what we've been trying to do is raise awareness of the problem, firstly. So we launched a campaign specifically looking at low and no pay, which you've all got the leaflets on your chairs, called Professionally Made, Professionally Paid. I mean, I hope you've heard of this in the last couple of years. And what we're doing is we're asking people to stop doing this, stop the mentality of thinking that performers' time is something you can have for free. I think it's a culture. When people are writing budgets, whether it's a small-scale film or a fringe theatre production, that there are things they know they've got to pay for. You've got to hire cameras and lights if you're making a film. You've got to pay a theatre exorbitant rent if you're putting on a play. You're going to pay for costumes, for props. And you go, oh, thank God we get to actors' wages. That's an optional extra. And you'll see it. You'll see that language in the breakdowns. They say, unfortunately, we are not able to. Well, it's not able. It's you haven't approached it in a way that made you able to do it, right? What we want is for the people who are putting on these shows to go and rethink the budget, if necessary, raise more money, work with other people, rethink the scale of what they're doing, maybe hire a bigger venue, whatever it takes to be able to offer professional wages. And we're promoting contracts that are the basic standard for people to do that on. So you may well have heard of our fringe theatre contract, which is a very, very basic equity contract for small-scale productions. We have equivalents for film. And we've been asking the people who offer the work to sign up to an agreement with the union to guarantee that they will stop offering unpaid work and they will meet basic legal standards and use proper contracts of employment. Right. I mean, it sounds pretty straightforward. It's been quite a struggle. But things are starting to go in the right direction. I mean, since we launched the campaign, we have had nearly 200 productions in Fringe Theatre using this contract. So everybody who works on them being engaged under proper terms. We've seen over £1.5 million in wages paid to actors and stage managers working in unfunded, tiny fringe theatres, places that look like this. Although actually, sadly, you know, on this stage, still some unpaid performers. But, you know, going to places where it is difficult and asking people to make a big effort to fix something which is damaging the industry. Look, the reason this matters, you can look at it as a trade union campaign to get more pay for our members, right? So it could just be about give more money to our members. But I think everybody who cares about this industry, cares about the ability of the arts to change people's lives and society, who cares about it being a successful part of the economy, which currently, it's a big success story, 5% of this country's GDP from the cultural sector, to take this seriously, because what happens if a big chunk of society is excluded from the workforce? You know, who can afford to work in London for a year or 2 years for nothing to be seen by agents to get time on stage? The quality goes. You know, when we launched this campaign, we had people like Julie Walters, David Morrissey, you know, high-profile equity members coming out and saying that their career path probably wouldn't be possible today. I used to work in another previous life for Glenda Jackson, when she was a member of Parliament. We talked about this all the time, you know. Her dad was a bricklayer, she's from the Wirral, and she went on to Rada, and if you went to see her playing King Lear, you know, you'd realise how important that is for British theatre to have talent like that. We risk losing all of that. You know, I think that the campaign is a good start to starting to push things back the other way. We want to try and make it so that some of the experiences you're talking about stop happening, so that people are not forced out of the industry at an early stage. And I hope you think that's a good idea. You think it's something you want to get involved with, and if you do, I'll tell you all about how you can do that later on.
Great, thanks. I just want to say, on behalf of myself and probably nearly every Equity member in this room, yeah, the work that you are doing for Equity has made such a difference to the grassroots of this industry, and I don't remember an Equity without you, to be honest. And everyone I speak to is like, oh, that Emmanuel guy. No, but it is. You are making such a big difference, and you are great. Thank you very much.
The Equity is as strong as its members. So if you are an Equity member, get involved in this. And if you're not, and you're a performer or a director, or you work in this industry, join today. I mean, that's the first step to making a difference. The forms are on your chat.
Right, I'm going to hand over to Tracy now. So Tracy's leaving us at 12:15. So she's going to speak a little bit about herself and everything. And then I'll open it up to questions. And if you've got questions specifically for Tracy, I'll take them first. And then we'll be able to, and hopefully Stephen will have arrived by then as well.
Thanks so much. Can I just firstly say congratulations to Equity for actually hosting this meeting. It is so important. It's so urgent. There are people whose lives and dreams are just being crushed because they can't make a living. So congratulations to all of you. Just to say, I mean, looking at the statistics, 73% of actors from middle-class backgrounds, 10% working class. Top British actors, 2% as likely to have gone to private school. I actually don't even know how I got started, because coming from a council estate in Batley, my dad was always at work. My mum sold white goods at the Yorkshire Electricity Board, but I always knew I wanted to be an actor. Didn't know anybody in the industry. Get the chance to go to university, first in my family to go, so I do drama. Then I get, I do drama, but I think, I want to be an actor. So I audition for Webber Douglas when it existed as for a postgrad. And I get a place, but I have no idea how to move on from there. I don't know anybody in London. I have no money. My family have no money. I'm stuck in Loughborough. I'm one of those sad people that are left behind when everybody goes on to their lives. And it was only thanks to one person I barely knew her. She said, come to London, sleep on my floor, you've got to get started. And that's what I did on Daily Issue at the DSS, getting money, you know, with all the addicts and the alcoholics. But it stopped me, you know, becoming a hostess, I suppose, and going down that path. So then I just applied for jobs. So it was all the jobs in the back of the stage. And I did 5 years in community theatre and theatre and education. Now, those opportunities are less and less out there. You know, where you would, I went to Ramsgate for a year and did TIE in Ramsgate, where you get a flat and that's where you're living. And, you know, moving around to follow the jobs. I could only do that because I had no property. I was staying on people's floors. It's increasingly difficult for people to have that opportunity to learn their craft. And then I get the big break, which is to play Sandra, the clumsy waitress. You're all too young to remember this. In A Bit of a Do. It was a great opportunity because it was a series on TV. Now, I know full well, the reason why I got that job is because I was real. I was authentic. I talk dead like that. I've got a bit posh now, but I was dead northern, and I was really real, and a bit vibrant, and a bit like, ooh, this exciting. And that's what they wanted for that role, and that's why I got the job. But of course, I didn't have the family backup or the money to actually make the most of it. So, hi, come here, come here.
Stephen.
Hi, Stephen, come take a seat. So I didn't have an opportunity to make the most of it. So I was waitressing at Kettner's, whilst I was playing a waitress in A Bit of a Do, and people were doing their first night reviews while I was serving them, going, oh darling, yes it was so, it wasn't Tristram great this evening. I'm like, shitting hell, what am I doing here? Anyway, so because the breakthrough is the TV role, so that was really helpful, that really got me started. But I was still in a co-op. And I would say to everybody here, if you can't get an agent, and if you don't go through the drama school route, don't dismiss co-ops, because it's like the lobsters in the pot. If the lobsters knew how they could help each other, then some of the lobsters would survive. And I think if we work together as actors, rather than waiting for other people to validate us, other agents to deign to take us on, let organise, be collective, work together. And that way you also understand a little bit about the industry of behind what we do, you know, how casting works, how submissions work, how to run a business. All of those skills are really, really useful. And so, you know, I was with in a co-op for 6 years, and it was really a great start. I mean, the question is, why does this matter? Well, it matters because performance and politics is so intertwined. And I don't know about you, but if anybody's had children, when I was pregnant, I've had two daughters, I could not be seen for anything if I looked pregnant. Why? Obviously it's insurance or whatever. But actually, then you look at TV, there is not one pregnant woman on TV in a storyline where it's not about her having the baby. Pregnant women are airbrushed out of every story, unless you're Olivia Colman, and because they want you, they write it into the story, or in Fargo. They are the only two examples I know, and I've been an actor for 30 years, where I have seen a pregnant woman playing a leading role where it's not about her having the baby. It's not right. You know, so to then to go into the workplace and to fight for women's rights and paternity, maternity leave and all of that, there are employers that don't even understand pregnancy. They don't understand that you're a doctor and that you have a baby, or that you're a solicitor and have a baby. You know, it's a massive political omission for our society, and it's got to change. So obviously, you know, why does it matter? Of course it matters. The question now is, whose fault is it? Now, as a writer, I work very hard to look at my diversity when I'm casting and so on. You know, it's actually quite shocking how I I'm hardwired to write bigger stories for men. So it's really, really important that we are also self-editing. I would also say that to everybody in this room, if you haven't already, start writing now, because the reason people drop out, and I love the idea of the leaky pipeline, the reason people drop out often is because it's too humiliating, the second job, sometimes. Sometimes you just can't do it anymore. For the money you paid, you just can't do it, which means you can't do you can't be an actor. So writing gives you self-esteem. It means you can create your own work. It means you're still in the industry and you're collaborating, so you hear more of what's going on. And the sooner you start, the better you get, and you can earn a living. And often, I can have a year writing on Hollyoaks. You can earn $100,000 a year. That's amazing, and it means you can do 2 years of theatre. Now, last year, before I became an MP, I'd had a good year. I had a nice part in the club. I played Paulina in Winter's Tale for Guildford Shakespeare Company, and Clara in The Vortex in Singapore with Jane Seymour. Both those two theatre jobs were £4.40 a week. £440 a week. Now, that is just about the minimum wage. Our wages have stagnated for the last 10 years. You know, if you're working for nothing and then you're expected to live for the rest of the year on your paid work, that is absolutely not enough. So it's important to start writing, because then you can change the idea of people's commission, what do we want to see. But also the writers then have to deliver to the commissioners. I was at an event with Tanika Gupta, a playwright, who had a really huge success at the Royal Court with a play about four older women, menopausal women, who go to St. Lucia and pay for sex with young guys. It was a huge hit. Channel 4 wanted to make it into a series. And one of the first questions in the commissioning meeting was, can you make the women younger? Now, the whole point of the story is that they're middle-aged. And also, Apple Tree Yard, has anybody watched it?
Yeah.
All the song and dance about a middle-aged woman having sex. You don't get that in The Night Manager. There's no conversations with Hugh Laurie about, how is it having sex with a young, gorgeous woman dripping off your arm. It is, the sexism is, it's invidious, and we need to be on it. So is it the audience that is actually controlling this? I would say no, because the success of Happy Valley, the success of Sally Wainwright's output, we are desperate for complex characters, often women who we haven't seen on our TV, over 50, with big issues and big stories to tell, impactful, angry stories that aren't pretty. You know, the audience are yearning for it. So is it the casting directors? Well, Nina Gold says, at the end of every drama show, drama showcase, where are the people who are overweight? Where are the people who are quirky? Where are the working class voices? And I'm on a bit of a rant here, but I would say, for I've written over half a dozen short films for Lambda graduates, and spending time with them, they're bespoke. I meet the young actors and I write for them. It's an amazing gift for them, because it means that they get something for their showreel even before they've left. And as I did more and more, I couldn't believe I was in these meetings with the young people in their 20s who've just done, have just been to Oxbridge, they're about to do a 2-year postgrad at Lambda, which isn't cheap, they're wearing a cashmere scarf, they've got a car and they live in London. And I think, I have no idea who you are. Where are you from? What planet did you, what do your parents do that they can afford this? And I kept saying to the people running the course, please just give me the people with working class backgrounds and voices. I could write better for them. And they're more interesting stories. And I did see a real rhythm of the people that they were taking. Although they are very good at bursaries and so on, there is a particular type. We can't get away from that. And I think we should encourage working class young people more and more to go into the industry, because you're going to be rare. And actually, you might work. Who knows? So is it the unsociable hours? Is it the reason why people the leaky pipeline happens, because people have families? There's an amazing organisation that I would urge you to look at called Raising Films, and they're looking at trying to impose the European directive on hours, which is all going to fall apart in any minute now, isn't it, with Brexit? But to try and get film companies to understand that we also need to have a life. for our mental health and our well-being. And certainly, certainly the BBC, my husband directs EastEnders, and he goes in, and it's long hours, they're on camera for 8, and they wrap at 7. But he's all right, because he comes in and does a gig, and then can recover. But the crew are working long hours, and it's actually affecting their output, and their mental health, and their family relationships. So, how do we challenge it? What do we do? Let's try and have some positivity here. We celebrate good practice. So, for example, Channel 4, brilliant, their diversity charter. The companies who are leading by example, for example, Shed, 49% of all their directors are women. Now, I wonder why that is. Shed is run by women, and they see it. So we need to get into senior positions. The National are also pushing for it, so we should celebrate good practice in that way. Drama in schools. You can't be good unless you practice. The earlier you start, the better you'll be. We understand it's a no-brainer. Taking drama GCSE out of schools is counterintuitive. Rise in antisocial behaviour, rise in mental health problems for young people. All of this stuff you can work through when you're doing drama at GCSE. We have to absolutely lobby for that, and I will be doing that. Support regional youth theatres. You know, when budgets are tight, the youth theatre is the thing that goes. So Nottingham Theatre Workshop, stuff like that is absolutely pivotal. Jim Cartwright's amazing drama school for all ages and all classes, where they write their own material. We need to be celebrating those. Lower the prices of theatre tickets. And I know it's under 26 is really good. But as you know, being an actor, it's not just about being seen in auditions. You've got to be seen networking. You've got to go to shows. You've got to see good practice. You've got to see good actors. You've got to network. You've got to see the casting director in the bar so that they remember you exist. We've got to get ticket prices down. Also, we need to audit drama schools. Now, I know there's lots of champions for the National Youth Theatre, and lots of amazing actors have come through that. However, I think it's poor practice to encourage young people who might not have any talent as an actor to keep applying, which they do. They say, apply next year. It's so expensive. And what you're doing is you're using that funding stream as part of your business plan. I would say it's unfair, and it's sad for people who should be thinking about other careers in the craft industries, maybe on the other side, in stage management or whatever, to try and boost people's dream and say, yes, just if you believe it, you can be it. But sometimes that's not true for some people. And I would say we need to audit drama schools who use applications as part of their business plan. There's only a few more, so we will move on. I also think build screenwriting into drama schools so that everybody has the ability to create their own work. Co-ops must not be seen as second class. Don't wait to be validated. Triforce Entertainment, and people know them? Mm-hmm. Absolutely amazing. And that's Jimmy Akinbola. He just like, I'm pissed off with this, we need to get together. He got colleagues together, and it might have been seen as like, oh, desperation, oh well, you know, early on. Now they're a force to be reckoned with. Now they're rolling it out in LA. I mean, it's an amazing organisation. Also, we need to encourage casting directors to, as I said, to employ pregnant women who are invisible. And also support these guys, because these sorts of organisations are the ones that are lobbying on our behalf. And I would agree, absolutely. Get involved. Do not wait for people to validate you. You make your own destiny. You be one of those lobsters in the pot. Work together, and you can change your future. And you can have. It's not just about the Cinderella story about somebody that came from a working class background. Claire Foy, she just won the Golden Globe. I played her mum in her first job in Doctors. You know, she has had an amazing journey, working class girl, done incredibly well. That's a real Cinderella story, but that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about social mobility. It's about the long tail of social mobility, but it's about people having regular jobs so that they can bring up families, so they can pay their bills, they can have a safe place to live and have some dignity in the profession they want to carry on with. So I applaud you all for coming today, because it means that you're actually interested in changing the world. So here's to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Tracy. And I will be watching you in Parliament and watching Indeed. You kind of crack on. So if you're not already following Tracy on Twitter as well, you put quite a lot of stuff on Twitter, don't you? So yeah, keep an eye on her. We'll be lobbying you.
Indeed.
Are you all part of the arts group yet?
I'm not. No, not yet.
We'll get you involved with that.
Yeah,
I'm sure
please.
The
I'd love
mother
to
will have a word with you afterwards. Two things that struck me, what you just said about the National Youth Theatre. My sister's a musical director and she's been taking the auditions for the National Youth Music Theatre. And I was absolutely shocked to hear that once you get a place as a child on that course, you then have to stump up £1,500 for 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Two weeks to work with them. So, I mean, if that's not a barrier in itself, like
totally.
Parents going, I can't afford, like my kid, it's like really expensive childcare, basically. I'm sure it's absolutely brilliant and the standards are very high, but that was like, what my sister did it when she was 16, so 14 years ago, it was nowhere near that much money to be involved with those organisations. So, I think that's something we definitely need to look at. And talking about, when you said about the job centre with the alcoholics and the... I went to the job centre once and I will never ever go there again because of the way I was treated when I said I was an actor, and they just looked at me and went, what are we supposed to do with that? People don't understand that we are a profession and a lot of us have a degree in what we do, and just the way the public treat actors and we are seen as this kind of second class citizen and go and get a real job, and we really need to start changing that attitude. And kind of when we're talking about ourselves as actors, I think we have to give ourselves a bit more respect. And what you said about the second job, like a lot of the time, oh, I'm an actor and I temp, like it's like that they go hand in hand, but actually no, first and foremost I will always be an actor, but staying creative and staying as whether you look at directing or script writing or other parts of the industry, and whether we need to kind of have that level of respect for ourselves when we talk about ourselves as professionals. So I'm going to introduce Stephen now. So Stephen, you're at Central School of Speech and Drama still, aren't you? So I'll hand over to you, and then I'll open it up to questions, and if you've got anything for Tracy first, because she's leaving in about half an hour. So, Stephen.
Hi. apologies for being late. I'm really, really sorry. I have really bad eyesight, and I read the time wrong. That's why I came late. Introduce me about myself.
Yeah, talk to us about and what you're doing.
So I'm a student at the Central School of Speech and Drama. I'm in my second year. I'm on the playwriting course. There's a new course that they've just put on called the Drama Play Theatre Writing for Performance, and that's a 3-year course. I am the Black and Ethnic Minorities Officer at Central, which means I represent all Black and Ethnic Minority students, and I do relevant SU events about Black and Ethnic Minority students. We've just had an event on in my first term as officer. I'm in my second year, so I'm in my second term as officer. In my first term, we had an event called Dear White People, which Tom attended, and that was all about challenging the institution about race and diversity. We thought if we keep our schools accountable, then obviously they have to answer. We pay them, so they have a duty to report back to them, and if we just give them money, then we're not doing what we should be doing. You know, we're actors, or we should be acting on something, or whether we're directors, we should be directing on something. And if we feel passionately enough that they're doing things wrong, we should be able to tell them, you are doing something wrong, and this is what we did even. This term we've had events on about, so I've just kind of had this whole thing about we shouldn't celebrate Black History Month. And that for me is important for me because the school needs to realise that we are not some token tin box. That for them, what they would like us to do is go in the bar or do an SU event, doing something to do with Black, and take pictures and put that in their report and something and say they are diverse, and actually they're not. So what we've done is we've taken away that month doing Black History Month or celebrating Black History Month, and what we've done, we put events in throughout the whole month. Every month in this year, there'll be lots of events happening, and they have been. For example, Aisha Casey Hayford, who's a trustee at For Change, she just came in this month, last week, to do a talk about hair and being a woman of colour and how hair and casting can affect you and what the differences are, and makeup artists and all these things. Who else? There's been lots of people who have come in and done lots of stuff, but it's all those, what we did, I think, what was important for us to acknowledge is that there is something that those masterclasses each month give to those students who don't have what they should be having, an education. lots of students are not getting, lots of black and ethnic minority students are not getting 100% out of their education as the white students are. They're not playing the parts that should be played. They're not learning about their culture that they should be learning because the teachers are there, do not know about the culture, do not know about how to deal with hair, do not know how to talk to them about, you know, writers and professors who were writing black plays, Asian plays. They don't do that. And so those things offer an alternative education, actually. And that's been quite successful. Anyway, and also I'm the founder of the Diversity School Initiative, and that came out of that Dear White People event, because we want to keep drama schools accountable on a regular basis. They're getting away with too much, and that's wrong. That's too wrong. And we should be able to tell them, you're wrong, here's how to do it, and we've done that. We've had meetings and talks with Bristol Oldvic, we've had meetings with Edward Kemp, and Edward Kemp has been great. And so has Jeff Coleman, who's head of acting at Central. They've been two great people who have understood that they don't know what they're doing and want help. And that is by far, I think, the greatest thing that anyone has ever said to me regarding these issues. Instead of somebody pretending and telling me and being defensive, and Edward said there's two things I could do. I could be defensive about my school, or I can acknowledge that actually there are things that we're not doing right. And he acknowledged there are things that he's not doing right. And there are things that he wants to change desperately, but he just doesn't know how to. And what we offer him is a solution or a guidance of how to get those things right and who to look at. So that's what I do and that's what I'm all about, really.
Thank you. I'm going to open the floor up now to some questions. Has anyone specifically got anything for Tracy, first and foremost? Yeah,
just here. I'm Jackie Sharp. I'm the just wondered, are you going to tackle the English baccalaureate situation? Do you know much about that in the schools? I think we need to reach children a lot younger because with this, with their options, they might start in year 7 and 8 or 8 and 9 some schools. Where if they're lucky, they get three options to choose what they want to do. But then the English baccalaureate, it's all on the academic subjects that you have to do. Now, if you only get two options in your school, you have to do humanities, history, and you have to do a language.
Yep.
So you can't do the foundations of performance, you know, the arts. You can't do math, you can't do, obviously, dance, drama, or music. Or you can get one. In my daughter's school, it was she's 20 now, my youngest, so she was the foreign intern, the guinea pig of her year, back in 2011, before the English baccalaureate. And it was that they had three options. So they had to do the two, then the one she wanted to do was music. But music was at the same time on the timetable as history. So what do you know what you're doing? That was something that she really wanted to do. So, but she was lucky, some schools don't even get that. So when there's pressure, it isn't compulsory as far as I know, but in November I sort of Googled, and they're trying to make it compulsory, so that you have to do that. They're just taking all the value out.
I think what happens is that's for schools because it makes them look more academic.
Yeah.
And both my daughters had the option to do drama, but my issue is that there's no consistency. And more than anything, I tabled an amendment for the apprenticeship bill about careers advice, because my nephew is 6'3", sensitive, a bit technical, he changes tyres on the motorway. And I'm like, Alex, you'd be a great boom op. I've no idea what you're talking about, Auntie Tracy. You know, because they're not offered those jobs either. So your careers advice is so limited. And, you know, I have apocryphal stories that it's the secretary in the school office that does careers advice. You know, we need to tackle that. Drama absolutely needs to be on the curriculum. Drama and the arts, so art and music. It makes us who we are, rounded, emotionally intelligent people, and we need that more than ever in the state of the world. And also, absolutely, statutory, good quality careers advice. I totally agree with you.
Are you aware of the Back for the Future campaign? So Equity backed the Back for the Future campaign, which was about exactly what you're talking about, the lack of opportunity to even be able to choose an arts subject, and how, and it is about to be made compulsory, I believe. So
there will we're already seeing a 43% drop in people taking art subjects, so I can only see it getting worse. But we can pass you the details.
Great, thank
you.
In 2011, I said, "You're doing it. How's it going to be?" And I'm surprised how quick now that has, and now the results are coming out. Mm-hmm. Like, only since 2011 now, and it wasn't compulsory. Now that they're trying to make it,
it's going to be. Yeah. I saw another hand for Tracy just over here.
Hi, Tracy. Thank you all. That's really interesting. Tracy, I saw you in the vortex. You were lovely.
So what's your name? Could you
Josh,
say your name?
My name's Josh Woodrush, but I'm an agent.
Oh, hello, Josh.
I have two clients with you, both very middle class. One of the things that I wanted to pick up, we speak a lot about Julie Walters and people like that saying, like, we've not been able to come through it. One of the reasons for this, I hugely admire older actors, and I've spent a lot of my career talking to older actors, but I can pass that on to my younger clients as a kind of thing. And one of the reasons, I spoke to Penelope Keith, and she said, you know, when we left university, we went and signed on, and we got paid, and we didn't need to do this. I know this from my husband, who's going through it at the moment. Every time he finishes a job, he goes to the job centre, and he's treated like he's some kind of scrounger. And every single time he gets a one-day promo gig, he has to come off benefits and reapply. Mm. This, I mean, every time I speak to one of my clients about this, they say, no, we just don't bother getting benefits. And I'm like, but you're paying into the system. Every time you're paying on an equity job, you're paying your tax, you're paying your national insurance. Mm. This is your right. Mm. You have the right to get this back, but they make it so difficult for them to pay into that. The other thing, and this may make me unpopular, please don't be confused by the accent, I'm very working class myself. but one of the things that comes up time and time again is the sense of entitlement. I speak to my clients who are paying £800-900 a month to live in zone one, and they're taking two holidays. I haven't had a holiday in 16 years. So what the fuck's that coming from? But they're buying all, it's the keeping up with the Joneses. It's my friend's got this, so I must have the flat in zone one. My friend's got the new iPad, I must have the new iPad. And then of course, 3 weeks after the job's finished, they're ringing me going, I'm so broke, I've got no money. And it's like, well, I can't afford new kits or new equipment. I don't understand this sense that everybody must have the same thing. It's appalling. And the other thing I just wanted to touch on was Spotlight. Somebody mentioned Spotlight earlier. Spotlight could do so much more to help actors who are working under the poverty line. I discovered only recently that Spotlight offered 50% off to disabled actors. It's not on their website. I mean,
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
No, exactly. Nobody knows that. It drives me insane. And as for Spotlight saying we're bringing in monthly payments, that I had a meeting with them in November and they said it would be in January. So we're still waiting on that afterwards, despite the fact that casting directors can pay monthly. I mean, I just think the entire Spotlight system is based not towards the service users who are actors, but towards an industry who don't actually pay very much for it, like me, agents. But the system actually works very well for agents, so we don't complain that much. I complain a lot because it is very unfair on my clients that Andrew Scott is paying £150 and his agent sees every single breakdown, and my clients are paying £150 and they're seeing 40% breakdown. It's not fair.
That's true.
I was at a talk last year. A couple of years ago, we did a student event with Spotlight, and we were told that if you're unrepresented, you're seeing less than 35% of the breakdowns, but yet everyone's still paying the same amount of money. And let's face it, it's going to be the working class actors that haven't got agents, that couldn't go to drama school, exactly as Tom said, that are the ones that can't even see the jobs. So yes, the system is completely flawed. But I was told that the monthly payments would be in time for actresses this year, which I believe is May. So I'll be making a phone call about
that. If I can put my head in the line, I'm not bothered. But because Spotlight do fund actor awareness. But because I'm kind of in there, I'd love, if you want to email me, what's wrong with it, which I will, I'll quite happily pass it on because I know Ben, the head of it, and I'll quite happily slap it on his desk and go, you know, sort that.
I've changed from the email Emmanuel every hour.
But yeah, I can't promise it's going to do anything, but at least I can get it on a desk, which is more than most, so I can do that, it's no problem.
Great. There was a hand here, thank you.
Hi, my name is Brendy, I'm Canadian, I've been here 2 months, and I'm an actor and writer, and I'm looking to sort of break in as a writer and get on some of those series. The only sort of place I've seen for applications is, I guess, semi-annually BBC does, you can kind of apply unsolicited scripts through that, but what was your process of getting on to write for Hollyoaks, or was it because you maybe knew some people having worked on it as an actor? And
No, I did a master's in screenwriting at London College of Communications. And then the second year of that MA, you write a feature film, and that became my sample script. So I would recommend everybody write one thing that is your voice, that is big and, you know, and impressive, and work very hard on that. Use your friends to edit, help edit with you. So that my first job was on Crossroads. So I just sent it in. I didn't have an agent for 3 years. Just got my own work through sample scripts. But the one way in, I would say, is doctors. Doctors at the BBC do take unrepresented writers. And also the BBC Writers Room, for all its privilege, actually does show opportunities. Yeah. There are courses, there are call-outs for unsolicited scripts. You know, they're solicited from them, but, you know, unrepresented scripts and so on. So the BBC are quite good at trying to find talent. But also, you know, we were talking in the bar earlier, but there's lots of courses, and it's courses for diversity, courses for, you know, women in comedy, but it's where those courses then deliver. I think there should be a bigger audit of actually, for all the money that's spent, then what happens to those people who've been on those courses. I think those are the two ways in. Or there's a thing called
a link, or so, like, how do you find the contact information for something like that?
For doctors, you just ring the BBC and go through to the department and just say who is in charge of new writers. Okay. I mean, give it a go. Yeah. I was just going to say something else. Oh yeah, Channel 4 have a thing for called Coming Up, I think it's called. That the Channel 4 has other opportunities. But I would also say, write something. You've got friends and colleagues. Make it, put it on the web.
And take it to Scratch Nights that Tom's doing.
And then you've got something, and it exists. And it exists, and it's there, and people can't say you're not allowed to do it. Good question.
Any other questions at the moment? Okay, yeah.
Yeah, I just wanted to touch on what you guys mentioned earlier about... by the way, hello, I'm Lisa Ronkowski, I'm an actor, I was born in Bradford in West Georgia. and I just wanted to ask if there's anything that you're actively doing about the issues of these children who get brought up in schools where drama isn't an option, you can't do it for A level, there's no option to do it at uni, then you take something else creative and you come out of uni and then you're back to square one, and it's kind of just a distant dream that didn't really happen anymore. You might not have the same support system, things like that. Just what are we doing to kind of help children have the confidence, really, and be able to believe that it is an option for them, even though it's nothing around them that's helping them? Do you know what I mean?
I think arts emergency are really good at that. Personally, I think... I think they tackle under 16s. Is it under 6? That's
one of them. Under 18.
Is it under 18s? Under
18s, mentoring. Isn't
under 18s, and they get mentors, so they've got such a vast network of people, and you get assigned a mentor to kind of guide you and have all those sort of questions. I know that's what they're doing, so they're a really good contact to have, kind of have for definitely under 18s, definitely. So if you definitely follow on Twitter, Neil is the contact. He's definitely a person to kind of do that. But I know they're doing really good work, and they've got, I'm sure, like 400 mentors and all that, which is really good. I met a girl who's in RADA at the moment, and Julie Hesmantall, who's Hayley on Coronation Street, is her mentor, and she's helped her get into RADA and put her in the right contact. So there is organisations she's got to dig.
Personally, as an actor, I work a lot regionally. I've just finished working at West Yorkshire Playhouse on The Witches. So there's lots and lots within theatres. There are a lot of schemes for free tickets for schools, and then a lot of the great places like the West Yorkshire Playhouse. I've also Liverpool Everyman. That was brilliant. We would do workshops with the kids when we were in the shows. So we'd talk to them about characters development. Like, I guess there were schools. It depends on the marketing departments within each school and their research and development departments. But I am seeing a change in the regional theatres. They, a lot of them are losing their funding, of which Equity is lobbying for day in, day out. We've got a campaign, Stop Arts Cuts, which is a constant one. But I do think funding our regional theatres is very, very important to getting it out of London. And the casting working party within Equity as well, which I'm part of, also are very, we're pushing for regional casting finding these Billy Elliots and these kids that are living in the middle of council estates that we just cannot get to.
Yeah.
If we fund the theatres that then become the community hubs, there's a way of fixing it. And I've worked with some fantastic actors that are based in these places permanently, and the amount of outreach work that they're doing is brilliant, but we could always do more. That's the thing. And
yeah.
With the funding disappearing, these kids are falling through the cracks, and they find themselves in a youth theatre, and it just kind of, I've seen the transformation literally within a 3-month period just working at that theatre with that school or whatever. So I think that's some of the things Equity and I'm personally doing as an actor. But I do think whenever you work regionally, you go and meet your research department, like within that theatre. The one I was just at had 13 staff members and that's why they were doing such great work. But go and introduce yourself and say, I'm happy to do workshops when I'm not like physically doing the show. And there's assistant directors there that will gladly drag you in and have them help. So that's what we can do, I think, on an individual level as actors. Dave, have you got any insight from where you're, like, the research that you've...
Yeah, I mean, so arts emergency are really good at this stuff. I mean, there's lots of things I can say. And, I mean, some of it is definitely appropriate to focus on things like schools and these sorts of closed routes in early years, because by the time we're kind of asking questions about drama schools, a lot of what the term would be, but the kind of the damage is done. But also, there are definitely parts of the sector that need to take a lot more sort of responsibility for this stuff. And it's slightly depressing in terms of seeing, you know, the struggle Stephen has had with Central, who actually, as you say, are quite open, you know, are sort of not as hostile to institutional changes. It's like the smaller campaigns, the individual things that like arts emergency and then the individual theatres, but actually we're dealing with quite a systemic problem.
And the thing, it really is all of it, isn't it? Because what you're describing are the people who are staring down that pipeline, you know, about to go in, right?
Yeah.
So I think every single one of the things that people are talking about, because, all right, so I'm quite focused on, you know, the terms and conditions of work, because that's where a trade union comes into things. But I don't think, I described it as that's the thing that hits you when you leave drama school, but I don't think it is that simple, because I think that a knowledge of what the industry is going to be like trickles all the way down. So if you're from outside of that club, like your parents' reaction when you talk about pursuing a career in the arts is very much influenced by what the industry is like, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I can remember having these conversations. So, nobody ever said you should be a trade union official. No, no child has ever dreamt of that. So, if you want to talk about careers that go wrong, we'll talk afterwards. But you know that the terms and conditions will affect how all of this is seen. Your parents are so much more likely to try and discourage you from following your dream if they know that the result is they are going to be expected to pay amounts of money they don't have. So I think every one of us is talking about the people that you've described.
Yeah.
Do you know the Almeida Theatre?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're brilliant. They've been doing outreach projects in like Arsenal and all the working class council estates.
James Smith, is it?
Yeah, there was a play on called Boy, if you've ever heard of it. It was got on last year. It was poverty porn, apparently. But basically, they went into outreach projects. They cast from the council estates. There's people there who hadn't had any theatre experience. The lead guy, I think he was like 16, got picked up and got paid, and he's now he's fantastic. But they're really good for those sort of things as well, in terms of outreach projects. And even with us, with the Scratch Nights, we get producers, casting directors, agents. We've had people picked up before from our nights. We've had shows on as professionally. So there is help out there. You just got to dig and find it.
That's it, and it's just getting the knowledge into the
schools. Yeah.
Tracy's got to go. Stephen, do you want to add anything to this question before I bring Tracy in, before she leaves? Don't have to.
No, I think Tom is right. There are things out there. There's the National Theatre, there's the Royal Court. And actually, what's really good about those kind of theatres is if you start working with them, they'll start giving you free tickets to watch their shows. All you've got to do is drop an email. I've never paid to watch a show at the National Theatre, and I've never paid to watch a show at the Royal Court, and that's because I work with both of them. And all I've got to do is say, can I go to a press night at this event? And they'll be like, yeah, sure, there's a free ticket for you. And so there's a win-win for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
They get to work with you get to work with them, but you also get to watch free theatre. And that's amazing, because theatre is really expensive.
Okay, Tracy, do you want 5 minutes to just sum up everything before you need to leave?
Thank you so much. I feel walking through the door, I was like, oh, my people. very different in the House of Commons. But I would say we have to be mindful that our industry is one of the strongest industries in the UK. It is expanding. It is our global identity, who we are and what we deliver, and we must be proud of that and not be apologetic that we want to be actors. And of course I'll work for nothing because, you know, I'm following my dream. No, we are workers in an expanding, rich industry, and we need to be paid properly. And gone are the days when actors were on the back of trucks and actresses were called prostitutes. We are in a proper industry, we're trade unionised, and we need to be paid properly with proper terms and conditions. And you know I will be an advocate for you at any point if I can help anyone in this room and beyond. I will be a champion because I know, certainly for young people, the theatre particularly is transformative. Not only watching it, but being part of it. It can change your life forever and find your sense of place and belonging. My sister is a nurse. When I said I wanted to be an actor, I was about 13, so I want to be an actor. She said, bear in mind this was in the 70s, so no disrespect to anybody. She said, why do you want to be an actor? It's full of puffs and nutters. And at the time, that's what we seemed like. We seemed like the weird ones over in the corner, but we're not. We are extraordinary, creative, and we contribute to the GDP, and we should be hugely proud of that. And just to say, I will be your champion. So anything you need, I'm there.
Thank you.
Thank you
for
your time. Tracy, you
dropped the card by that
fourth.
Oh,
thank you.
Thank you.
What is it?
Oh,
someone important.
yes, the slate.
Just following on from what Tracy was saying, I want you to like pick on what you were thinking about the working for food. So I feel like in my personal experience, as a dilemma, sorry, I've got a cold.
Yeah, no, I'm not used to being on this side of the set.
There's a dilemma. Of course, I don't think that anyone wants to work for free, and you want to validate yourself and your skills, especially when you've invested so much in drama school and stuff like that. But also, I don't want my CV to look blank year upon year. So I've just done a play, and it was profit share. The first part of it was free because of where it was playing and because of the script and me really liking it. I just wanted the panel, actually, just to kind of help us all, hopefully, in that decision of, like, how to make that decision. Like, because it's a hard one. You want the experience, and if you're not offered the opportunity, you're trying to create your own opportunity, and sometimes that involves working for free. And then, also, I've got two questions.
That's okay.
The other question was for Stephen. And just following on about mentorship, is that something as well that you are trying to push for at Central, and what is happening with mentorship and its attachment to drama schools for ethnic minorities or non-white people?
I'll start with the question for Stephen and then we'll open it out to the more generic working for free.
Totally, that's mentorship is a big thing, and one of the things we want to push for and lobby for. That, I mean, the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland, they do this. They have each of their students who are on the acting course have mentors who are graduates. I think that's the main thing for me personally. I've been lucky to have some mentors who've been like Cobnell Smith, who's been talking to me about acting and like, you know, stuff about his own experiences, which I've been able to relate to. And sometimes, as a drama student or as an actor as well, of working class, of ethnic minority, sometimes the journey's a bit bleak and it starts to become a bit like, I don't want to be here. And actually what's really helpful is having someone who can be like, I've been there before and actually I'm doing really well, or this is the advice that I can, you know, give you and all of that. So we're pushing for that. We have a mentorship scheme. So we have a membership scheme that if you sign up on our free membership, you get a mentor, you're placed with a mentor. That who can help you in regards of what you want to do. If you're an actor, we can pair you with an actor. If you are a director, we can pair you with a director to make it if you're a student. I think this is something so important in having someone that you can relate to, someone that you can speak to, that isn't quite seen in drama schools.
Yeah. So let's open it out to the working free. I'll start with Emmanuel because it's his baby.
Right,
when
well,
do you make that decision?
Settle down and get comfy.
When is it appropriate to work for free?
This is going to take a while. look, what you're describing, every one of our members goes through the same mental process, and lots of other people. And actually, I mean, loads of people have nothing to do with this industry because this is a problem it's across society. You know. Unpaid internships, working for nothing, the expectation that you will give your time and your professional skills to somebody else for no financial reward. And I know you were saying there's all these other reasons, so you're talking about doing this play just now because you like, you know, I've heard that the reasons actors take jobs is, you know, the script, the people, the director, the part you're going to play. I mean, there's so many factors. And I think anyone, when they take any job, you look at all of that, and the money is only ever one bit of it, right? You know, and you have to weigh it up against other things. So there's a side of the answer to your question, which is something I could never give you advice on. It's the stuff that's in your heart. Is that a play that you care about passionately being part of? But I do have loads of practical advice. Firstly, so you're clear on where you stand if you're a member of Equity, and it's just because I hear people getting confused about this sometimes, there is no judgment, criticism, condemnation from your trade union for you choosing to take work for no pay or to pay to be in it or whatever. Other unions in other countries with different structures have rules like that. Here you're absolutely free. Equity in the UK will not tell you which jobs to take. We're there to support your career, not to try and control it. Our issue is with the person at the other end who is offering the work, because I don't know, and I'm sure you probably don't want to talk about it in a public setting, which theatre you're working at, but I meet the producers of all of these profit share shows, and I can tell you the level of responsibility, the seriousness with which they approach their shows is totally different between the ones who are running budgets that will pay on our fringe agreement. So, you know, one answer is you can ask yourself, well, what else is out there? And you can now go on Spotlight and search for work in the Equity Fringe category. So fringe theatre jobs which are paid are there listed separately from the opportunities bit. You can go on our website, the Professionally Made, Professionally Paid section, and see a list of the employers who have signed agreements with us. So if you want to do fringe work, look at what is going on at the King's Head, at the Hope Theatre, at the New Diorama, Fringe Theatre of the Year, as of last week. Very, very proud to have been working with them for a long time. Theatre N16, German Street Theatre, the other room in Cardiff, all operate on equity agreements. There's another 15 production companies you can look up and see what they're doing. So there's some paid work doing the same sort of stuff, which might make the decision easier for you. If then you are going to go ahead and do it, make sure that you get what you want out of it. Because what I come into contact with is when things have gone wrong all the time. Right? And usually people knew that their pay was going to be terrible when they went into the job. I mean, there is sometimes with profit share, people get misled or have the impression that there's a realistic chance of profits when there isn't. But generally, people know the pay is going to be terrible, but can still end up very, very angry about it 2 or 3 weeks in. And that's because other things have gone wrong, which you could protect yourself from. In the simplest terms, just get in touch with us when you're thinking of taking a non-equity job. I mean, that is advice for everyone in this room who's thinking about taking work. If you are going to take work on an equity contract, you can pretty much go for it fairly relaxed that everything will be fine in your terms and conditions. If it's not an equity contract, the chances of you having a miserable experience are infinitely higher. The quality of the contracts in front of you will probably be terrible if you're offered a contract at all. Get in touch with us. You can all have my contact. In fact, my phone number is on the back of that leaflet. Give me a ring, I'll look at what you've been offered and tell you what you need to watch out for. If you're going to work on a profit share, if you care at all about how the money's going to work, make sure you know what your share of profits is, how the calculation is going to be done. Simple questions. If you're doing a student film, make sure you have a contract that's going to guarantee you the showreel. Because if that's why you did it and you end up not getting what you wanted out of it, you're going to feel very angry about the unpaid part. Protect yourself, because if you're not from within the club, right, you are at every stage more vulnerable. You're more vulnerable to the kind of, you know, the scams that are out there at every level, you know, the photographer's scams, the bad training courses scams, the pay to play, the, you know, rubbish profit share producers. You're 10 times more vulnerable to every one of those problems because you don't know, you know, you can't ask your uncle who's a, you know, big shot from like one of the clubs where they all hang out to say, you know, do you know this person? You won't have heard of the names. Everything's against you. So join your trade union. That's your basic protection. That makes sure your legal rights aren't trampled on and you have access to this huge network of information. And then ask questions. Make sure you know exactly what you're getting yourself involved in if you do end up. And I think the end result will be, if you go through all of that, there are fewer of these things that you will be interested in. Because sometimes you'll start asking questions about how is this profit share going to work, or can you guarantee that if I get an audition for paid work that I won't be there? And you're getting answers that are starting to sound a lot less committal than what it said in the breakdown. All of a sudden, you're under huge pressure not to go to an audition. I mean, I've seen these things with my very eyes. You should run a mile. You're not going to get what you want out of that job. You're going to give 2 months of your life to somebody else for their benefit. So.
Yeah, I mean we see this in the fieldwork we've been doing, and I sort of deal with sort of social patterns. That's, you know, what my kind of interest is as an academic. And what you see is that the routes through unpaid or free work are so different depending on where people have come from. So across the sector, everybody's like, "Oh, you have to work for free. You know, you've got to do it. That's how you'll get a job." But actually, there are completely different kinds of free work. So there's sort of like the work you might do with your friends, who, you know, maybe you go to drama school with, or maybe you're sort of like part of a collective with, and that is to do with you guys putting on productions and, you know, maybe trying to make statements or something like that. Versus what is a sort of employer-employee relationship. And unfortunately, what we've observed is that the employer-employee relationships tend to be experienced more by those from working class origins. They tend to get into these precisely these situations where, you know, they're working for a student film that actually never even gives them any footage. Or they're kind of being promised headshots at the end of it. Or they've been offered, I mean, we saw one that was a full 6 weeks tour of Europe doing Shakespeare, unpaid. And it was just somebody is making money for that. So I think this is the thing of like, it can be difficult to sort of, you know, I guess put yourself in a position of like, who am I, what part of the industry am I getting into? But on a really basic level, there is that kind of question where you ask, who is profiting from this? And basically, like, if it's you and your friends taking a risk, which tend to be what those from more affluent social origins do, and it tends to be what they say when they mean unpaid work, it's, you know, we took a show up to Edinburgh, unpaid work, versus, am I about to do a job for someone that they're just not going to pay me for? Because what you'll find is, as you come, you know, to kind of like try and get hired and, you know, talk to people about the experience you've got, what they'll do is look at what you've got and say, actually, all of this is pretty rubbish. You know, you've not done anything kind of serious. You've done, you know, poor work for no pay, for people we've never heard of. And actually, it's a way of you almost sort of like setting yourself up to be excluded. So, but that, I mean, it's really harsh to kind of put the responsibility back onto you. I mean, we should be talking about the people who see this as a business model.
Mm-hmm.
And also, and the audiences that go to this stuff as well. Like, we know from other research that it's basically the most affluent, best educated 8% of British society that consume most of the arts in this country. They can well afford to pay for productions that, you know, can pay people and are not, you know, exploitative. And yet, like, that kind of responsibility for them to say, almost like ethical food, you know, or like fair trade, like, I've checked where my theatre has come from and I'm comfortable paying
yeah.
for it, versus a sort of, you know, I've got no idea who's making the profit from here, but, you know.
And that's what we've been trying to do by publishing the information through our website and our magazine and all the outlets that he has about this list now of employers in a sector where traditionally, until 2-3 years ago, there were no standards. so that you can actually inform yourself. And we encourage our members to make informed choices about which shows they go to see, so that financially, in a very direct way, we're supporting the employers who are making such a huge effort. I mean, you know, what you're talking about, go to see a play at the King's Head, you'll be asked for money after you've bought your ticket on the way in and the way out. Right? You know, they are going to tap you up because they know that the people in that room are paying 20 quid to see the show, and we'll put another 20 into a bucket on the way out, and they use that money to pay actors' wages. So, you know, it is happening.
It's a difficult situation because I go for the same thing in terms of free work. Actor awareness, we started out scratch nights, it was free. But we gave guarantees in terms of, we know we were going to get agents in that room, we know we were going to get casting directors in that room, we know we were going to get reviewers, we know we were going to give you sort of thing. Emmanuel gave me a little bit of a nudge, and now we pay. And we did. We found Spotlight. Well, thank God Spotlight came on board and saved it, because I couldn't afford working at RSVP selling fruit and veg to do it anymore. And it's hard. So unfortunately, I was lucky in terms of Spotlight coming on board, and now we're the only paid scratch night in the UK. So it's brilliant. But you've got to be strict with yourself. And in terms of free work, don't let it eat into your work time. Be strict and say, no, I can only rehearse 7:30 till 9:30 at night, and they go, well, I can only rehearse. Oh, I don't care. I don't care. You fit around me. You're not paying me. This is your baby. I'm part of your project. Yeah. You work around me. Yeah. And you've got to be so, if it loses your job, you're not losing any money out of it. You've got to be strict with yourself, and you've got to be, and that's the thing, you've got to really assess it, and student films are the worst culprits for it. They're so, oh, it's good material for your showreel. Oh, is it? It's shit. you've got to be strict with yourself, and you've got to be strict with the material, and you've got to know the people behind it and question them to no end. It doesn't matter. You're not losing anything out of it. If you're strict with yourself, then you'll get something out of it. If it's not paid, I understand. I've done it before. But you've got to be strict, and if they're not happy with you, like I said, you're not losing any money.
Yeah. I have to say something else, because it's really good. It'll be really quick. Other things you can do. If you're going to turn down, right, if you've looked at a job that was for some reason appealing, or you've been offered it, right, you will, I imagine every one of you will get contacted at some point in the next 12 months and asked to do your professional work for nothing. Right? If you're not up for it, if you want to turn it down, instead of just swearing at your computer and deleting the email, go on our website. This isn't in the restricted bit, you don't have to remember, anyone can get this stuff, right? On the campaigns bit, freshly made, freshly paid, there's a template letter for you to use to send to that producer. You can change it as much as you want, but if you want it to take 30 seconds, just send it as is. It's very polite, but it explains to them that what they are doing is contributing to a problem in the industry, that there is an alternative. They may not realise that there are these equity contracts which are realistic and affordable for their budgets. They might think, well, you know, I'd love to pay that, but it's 500 a week. Well, it's not under our French Theatre agreement. It gives them the contact details, and it works. It's a way that you, as an individual performer, can use your ability and your standing in the industry to bring an employer to the table to try and change their working practices. And some of the people you see on that list who now pay everyone, that's why they came to talk to us, because they received 20 of those letters from equity members.
Yeah.
Because in the past, they would hear from the actors who are prepared to do it. Right, and there's always going to be 100 people who are prepared to do it. But if you're in that group that would do it if the money allowed you to have a career, you're probably the one they want. You know, you're the one just out of their reach. So it is quite a powerful way that you as an individual can do something without getting in a row with anyone or putting yourself at risk.
And I mean, if you want to be, like, I've personally turned up to auditions knowing that there's these forms being signed at the audition table saying, I accept that I will not take any money out of this, and there is no profit share, and I know that I'm a volunteer, and all of this stuff. And I've turned up knowing that form was going to be there and said, sorry, I'm not going to sign that, and walked away. And even that can make a statement, but it's about us all doing it together and being that collective, and that's what equity is really about, standing together so that you're not singled out individually as that difficult person. Also, have a very honest conversation with your agent about, please don't put, personally, 3 years ago, please don't put me up for any work at the union. I'm not willing to do it. And it was a very difficult conversation because the work is good and agents do go there. And my agent and casting directors, and my agent was really annoyed with me for saying that. But it was a decision I made to not work for free, and hand on heart, barring a few charity gigs, I haven't done any work for free. And actually, I'd rather go and earn 25 quid an hour in a hedge fund than undermine the rest of my industry. So that's a decision that I personally made, but it's not for everyone. Lots of hands up. So can I just get an idea of how many people still want to ask questions? Oh, lots. Okay, so let's try and make our answers really short so I can get through as many people as possible. So this gentleman here.
I have two questions, actually. I'll try and get them done. They're quite short. One was to David. Very early on, you said something about drama schools making assumptions about what kind of people should be doing it. Are those assumptions conscious, or are they unconscious? And if they're either way, what are people doing to try and dissuade them from those kind of assumptions? So that's the first one. The second one is on the same subject, really, about low and no pay. When you see that sentence in a breakdown, we are students and therefore we can't afford to pay actors, that's just bollocks, because they pay for all the equipment and they're paying for their
film schools.
Course. Yeah, film
schools.
Surely Equity can do something with the schools themselves to do something about that, because they're a captive group. They're not just some maverick guy who's making a film and not paying people. They're a group that you can access easily and change their attitudes. So that, Bob, please.
Dave, do you want to answer the first question?
I mean, Stephen probably talk to this a bit as well. We found kind of conscious things that are about admission tutors' perception of the market. So, they'll be kind of like, we don't need a class full of young blonde women because the market is kind of oversaturated with that particular social group. So there's no point getting, all 12 of our entry to be those people. Then there will be, kind of medium level conscious unconscious, where it's to do with like, well, we'd like a good, kind of set of actors this year, so we'll try and create a balance, and then there are kind of really problematic unconscious decisions that are basically to do with what talent is perceived to be. And there was some good research done with London visual arts schools, so like Central St Mines, RCA, these kind of institutions with admissions tutors, and they'd say things like, we only see talent. We don't even kind of think about who the person is. We only see talent. And then when you look at their admissions rates, there are lots of Chinese students because they can afford to pay the overseas fees. And then there are almost entirely affluent, middle class, white people, predominantly female, but some men as well. And so it's clear that kind of what talent is assumed to be on an unconscious level is basically what the drama tutors think of themselves. And there's this, this is kind of technical, but what we're seeing is kind of hiring or admissions as cultural matching. So what talent is basically, it's people like me, I know what talent is.
Yeah.
And then, we've got to shape the year, we need the right kind of year, and then there's, we know what the market will take, and it won't take, 12 young black working class actors from Manchester. There are definitely kind of things that we need to be doing in terms of kind of unconscious bias training, but also there are sort of much more kind of we need to be much more transparent about what a year is constructed around, as much as we need to be, to kind of stop people just admitting people like that.
So would there be positive discrimination in those cases?
We might disagree on this, but I don't even think it needs to go that far. I think it's about kind of honest conversations about how decisions are made, and then moving on from that to kind of say, what are the assumptions you're making? And, kind of some of those assumptions need to go, and other assumptions, maybe are kind of fine. But because the process is quite opaque at the moment, we've kind of done work with this to try and bring this out. And we know from the art school work as well, that other people have done, but if you go and have a conversation with a bunch of drama tutors, as we did, we're with a couple from around London, you'll run into lovely, liberal, metropolitan, cosmopolitan people who say, it's just about talent, and we need to do more, it's just about talent. And then you say, but look at these figures, this is what the industry you're producing. So I don't even think you need to go as far as the kind of quotas. Positive discrimination is maybe two steps away from where we are now.
Stephen, do you want to answer that?
A while ago, I think last year, well, it was last year, because we were only in January. But last year, I had a meeting with Jeff Coleman, who's the head of acting at Central. And this meeting was to do with diversity. And I said, Jeff, let's get straight to the point. How do you
get the actors? What's your, you know, what's the casting? How does that work? How do you choose the actors? And Jeff simply said to me, Stephen, it's nothing to do with class or race or whatever. I just pick the right person. You know, whoever walks in that room is the right person. And in my head, I thought, well, is white the definition of right?
Sure.
Because when you look closely on the acting courses, if you look on the BA acting, the BA acting, the conventional acting room, it's the majority of those are all white actors. There's one black male on first year acting. There is one black female on first year acting musical theatre. And then you look at CDT, the Collaborative Devised Theatre course, which is the unconventional theatre, the one where you get to devise your own crowd, that kind of theatre. And that's where you look, that's where all the minority actors are in. And that's quite funny, because you look at the history and you look at all these, the CDT course is quite new, you know, it's new. So it's like, oh yeah, that's where they can all go and do that stuff. But actually, they're not good enough to be on the acting conventional, you know, the stray acting or the acting musical theatre course. Well, these courses have been here for, you know, for the things that started Central, if to be honest with you. Yeah, it's hard. It's tough. And it's not fair. And it's not right for them to give us
courses. And presumably a lot of the black and ethnic minority and working class
people exactly.
Are not prepared well enough either. Whereas the middle class ones who went to a good school.
Or can't even afford the audition.
Yeah.
Is it £45 now to audition for Central?
Yeah.
I mean, I auditioned for 6 musical theatre colleges and I think they were £30 a pop when I was there. And I think they're all about 40 or 45 now. And I mean, luckily for me, I took a gap year in order to afford to go. So I worked in a bank, but I was doing Arts Ed Foundation course 3 nights a week and living in Essex. So I was like all over London. And they go, well, that's what it takes to be an actor. But it doesn't if you've got working, like middle class parents that bought a car for you that live in Hampshire. And it's just a totally different world for these, like for different people.
I think drama schools need to start being held accountable for, personally.
Yeah.
Last year I started a campaign, hashtag why the fee. And I attacked all the drama schools on Twitter and Facebook because I knew they can't hide from that. Now, 2 of them replied, Arts Ed thing. I said, why do we pay for audition fees? Why are you charging 75 and why is someone else charging 30? It should be, I know there's, unfortunately, you're not going to waiver the fee. If by the looks of it, it's not going to happen. I've tried holding them accountable for, and they could not physically give me a breakdown of what those audition fees go towards. Mm. Now, they either need to be waivered, or there needs to be a flat rate fee of £30 for everyone. Why is Central better than Manchester Man Met? Why are they such high gaps between them? So they need to be held accountable for either release a public breakdown of what those fees go towards. If not, there needs to be a flat rate fee of £30. When you go into that audition room, there needs to be full day's workshops, not 2 minutes for a monologue, 2 minutes for a song, see you later, you go back to Manchester.
No feedback.
No. Yeah, no feedback. It needs to be feedback forms given, because I see them all writing them down. Whether they're just doodling, I don't know. Or it's just boring your audition, maybe. But that needs to be a thing, and I've spoke to Equity about it, and it needs to happen, because it's getting ridiculous now, and they're so good at just brush you aside in terms of not being held accountable for what they're doing, and it comes into equality and diversity as well. They need to change their ways. Drama School UK is folded now, so something needs to be a big reshuffle in the drama schools, because they're getting ridiculous.
I think they do that on purpose.
Yeah.
They because they know the sorts of people they're trying to attract can afford it.
Yeah.
The people that, us normal people, we're not going, you know, do you think about it? I know a person who spent £200 to go to an audition. They're from Newcastle, working class from Newcastle, coming all the way to London. They have to spend money as well to live here for the day or for the night or whatever.
Right.
And then the train as well, and then for the audition. It's a ridiculous amount of money. And then, you know, you're paying for hope or chance because you don't even know you're getting through.
Yeah.
You know, so you're actually wasting your money. But on to the point of quotas, and if we need to, positive discrimination, whatever. I actually think quotas need to be introduced in drama schools. For too long, we've been waiting and waiting and waiting. You know, I'm on the Quota and Diversity Committee at Central,
And then they've just told me that they're going to do some new research project. And I said, this is BS. because you've been doing research projects forever. We all know, we're all here and we all know what the problem is. You don't have enough working class people in this school. You don't have enough diverse people in this school. There's not enough disabled people in this school. All of them are straight, middle class, working, middle class white men. You know, it's not fair. So we do need to introduce quotas to get into the system. We are good enough, we know we're good enough. So the whole fact of quotas will introduce, am I here to tick the black box? That's BS, because actually I am good. I am good to be here. I am as good, if not better than you. And I think quotas give us that space, that room to get in there.
But I think quotas need to be crossed over as well, because then there's a situation when I went to drama school where a lot of the black people who were a minority still, but a lot of the black people that were there were middle class black people. So here you've got a situation where drama schools are then taking on black people off of a very specific experience in life.
Yeah.
So I stood out like a sore thumb because not only am I black and female, but I'm working class. So there's three things that this place isn't really geared towards.
Yeah. Personally, I think the solution...
Okay, I'm going to have to take this back in hand. No, we've got lots of questions. Emmanuel needs to answer the low and no pay in film scores. It's a great discussion, but I do want to get all the questions out there. So let's attack the film scores.
Any of you ever done a student film? Mm-hmm. Right. When I got hired, I wondered why ECTI members were banging on about student films. I thought, this is really weird. They're just nice things. I mean, they're students. They're just doing something lovely. And now you guys want them to pay you. That's outrageous. Why are we attacking students? And it's only when I actually found out how it works, I realised that it's completely wrong what is happening, because it's not the student. The student is being told to make a film as part of their studies. They're being told this should be a professional quality production. And then they are sent out into the world to hire a whole bunch of people, not just actors. It's film schools that we're talking about. Other institutions do it as well, but there is a big group of them. And film schools have money. I mean, often they're set up as charities. But the real test is, are they paying for anything else? Well, yeah, they're paying for everything else on the production. And so they're buying into exactly the same culture and the same a mistake of seeing performers' time as an optional extra, as a freebie you can get. And we've tackled the film schools on this. Initially, there was a lot of resistance. We got a lucky break because an ECTI member happened to be the chairman of the board of a film school. And we were able, through that route, solidarity amongst our members, to get a meeting and put the argument across. And in the end, they had to accept that where the students are raising money and spending very large budgets. The average budget is for a full-scale production in the final term is £5,000 to £7,000. That it was morally wrong that the actors were being expected to do things for free on that basis. And we now have an agreement with the London Film School, which covers all of their final year productions, that they use the ECTI student film contract, which guarantees pay, a paid holiday, even if it's a one-day job, because it's a legal right. Terms and conditions that you would expect any contract to have, your hours of work. I mean, the number of times you will be offered contracts that don't even have your hours of work in. It's not fit for purpose. And the DVD. And they make all of their students use that for every single graduating year film. So that's the first time we've managed to get that. And we're trying to use it to make the case to the others. It's not as easy as you think. They're very resistant to this. I don't understand why, because I think it's better for their students, and the LFS experience shows that. LFS have been surveying their students on how this is going, and the students absolutely support it, because they're in the creative industries too, and they want to push back against this culture, because they want to feel like professional filmmakers, not amateurs who are relying on people doing them a favour, because they want to be able to tell the actor, this is when you come to work, this is when you leave, you're not on break now, put that down. You know, to be able to actually employ someone, you have to actually pay them. And I hope that for the campaign this year, the big priorities are to get more film schools onto agreements, to get a big impact in the regions, because we've got a good blueprint in London now, we want to roll it out nationally. So I hope that I'll be able to tell you about more film school agreements very soon.
The lady in the scarf, you've had your hand up for ages.
I was going back to what Tom was saying about like the fees for. So I went to fees for fee. I didn't do the straight acting. I did Royal Performance, which is one of the newer courses. And so after paying all the audition fees for everything, they then asked for a £300 fee for the year, which they're like, it's for theatre trips, it's for the training, everything like this. For the first year, we went, and obviously we're new students, we're from drama school, oh my god, we're here, like kind of thing. And then it's like, okay, we're going to a few theatre trips, that's all paid for, that's brilliant. And it got to the end of the first year, we're like, cool, we've done all that. Second year, did the same. Third year, we realised we'd all grown a bit of a backbone by this point. We've been to two shows that year, and we've been asked to pay for all of our own costumes for two productions. Bring our own stuff in. And so we kind of boycotted our class, refused to do anything more, until we found out where our £300 for that year, because we paid £900 over 3 years, so where our £300 for that year were gone. We wanted either more theatre, to go to theatre trips or anything, or have our money back, because we paid that money for them to, that was what the money was for us to be able to go theatre trips and us to do things like acting and buy those groups. And in the end, they didn't like it, obviously, because they weren't getting the money that, oh, well, they paid £300, but we've only spent £240 of it. That's £60 per student, and there was 20 people in my class. That's a hefty amount that you could just, like, pocket. So we ended up going to see Titus Andronicus, because we had, like, badgered our like, what my point is that, do you think, with the thing about being able to stand up for yourself with contracts and things like that, do you think that's something that is lacking? Because all we were taught in drama school as well is that, well, if you're late, professionalism, obviously, that's mm-hmm. something that needs to be big, but it's kind of, you're replaceable, someone else can do your job.
Mm-hmm. I personally think the solution is, and this is going to equity, I've been badgering on for ages, there is a disability committee, there is a race committee,
yeah.
there is all that sort of thing, but there's not a class committee. I think, personally, if you set a class committee up, these sort of issues can be... Because when you talk about class, it's always swept under the rug. It's always like, oh, it spreads across all six of them. Well, that's brilliant, but I think there should be a class committee that tackles things like that, tackle the drama schools, go on like that, because all these sort of committees are brilliant, and they're wonderful, and they tackle gender, they tackle race, they tackle all that sort of stuff. But then class gets put on the back burner in some sort of aspects, because there is other quotas and things that are more important, whereas I think if there's a class committee that it can definitely help and tackle those sort of issues, and there's someone there to kind of start pushing these sort of things through. I don't know if you agree, I don't know.
Do you think if something like this was to happen in drama schools, like a discussion like this, to make people, like students,
well,
aware
well,
they actually
we
have
do
a,
them.
Have
you ever had one? I know. So... And when you start a discussion in a drama school, in my experience, it kicks off.
Yeah.
I mean, I do these talks in theatres all the time with the cast that are actually working on these unpaid jobs. And often the focus is on the work, you know, and people are quite resigned to what's happening. The shock, when I give those same stats that I was talking about at the beginning, to a room full of people who are about to step out into that world, there's something wrong. If they haven't been having these discussions for 3 years. So we will be, unfortunately we had a bit of staff turnover, but we're gonna have a new student organizer coming in very soon. We're trying to run a program so that essentially nobody goes through mainstream drama education in this country without having at least one opportunity to hear from the trade union about what it's gonna be like in the world of work. But the schools themselves must be preparing people properly for a career in the industry. There's a tension there. Like there are reasons it's not happening. There's an obvious tension between selling education for, you know, as your business into an industry where there are not the jobs to meet the number of people you're selling that education to. You're not exactly motivated to point out to those students that what you're taking their money for could be quite tough. But it has to happen. It absolutely has to happen. So, in practical terms, if you or anyone you know wants to have a discussion like this in your class, in a cafe, in the like the with the company that you're working with, drop me a line. We'll arrange somebody to come.
Well, at the moment,
hang on, through the chair.
I told you.
I'm going to add two things to that. So, equity branches, they are regional. So, get involved with your local equity branch. Branches are all trying to get into more schools. We have 56 equity staff members. They can't be everywhere to everyone at all times. So the more members we can train up, this is something you can personally do, is get involved in your branch, be a student like liaison officer, or like and talk to whoever our new student organizer is and educate yourself on how we can help each other. That's one thing. And the other thing, the previous student organizer told me that, so we have the equity student graduates, the student scheme, 28,000 people are eligible to join that. I mean, if that's not scary, that there are 28,000 people at drama schools that are eligible to join our student scheme, I don't know what is scary. And that's how many people are just about to graduate to try and be an actor. So just bear that in mind but I mean, there's so much more we can be doing with schools. Okay, we've got 9 minutes left, so I'm gonna take a question down here.
Just need a couple of minutes then.
And then I'm going to have to give everyone a minute to wind up, and I just want kind of like two positive things that we can take from this discussion of how we can move forward.
Hi, my name's Ariane. I'm the founder of something called the Different Women Project. It predominantly represents BAME, LGBTQ, female point of view. We are working on promoting awareness and diversity in the industry, so I'm so glad that I finally seen you, because I don't know who to talk to. One of the things that's really, really obvious to me, listening to all of this, I'm currently working with South East London branch with Fiona to run a seminar called the D-Word Seminar on Diversity, and it's hopefully going to be run on the 25th of March, we think, at the Young Vic. It all needs to be confirmed. The reason I'm coming up with this now is because one of the things that I've found really difficult, I've heard you all kind of mentioning facts, figures, very qualitative research. If there's a way for us, because equity is brilliant in putting all these things in documents, making them downloadable, for us to collate these figures so that the people that do want to create change can have easy access to it, because it's really hard to get people talking about facts and figures, and they're the things we need when we sit in front of drama school panels and say, please can you have us in to our school. So for example, with my lecture, it's ready to go, I'm a qualified lecturer, but I need to have that stuff to bounce off and to have those conversations with people. So is there a way for us to make those, with the greatest respect, I realise you've put a lot of work into this, I'm not asking you to do my work for me, but by the same token, it is really difficult, because if you're waiting for weeks to get working actors' replies, and just to bounce off what you were saying about education, there is, I think, a huge, certainly as a mixed race performer, that, you know, the Different Women Project family, because it's for people that don't quite fit the mould, for someone that's quite different, that maybe doesn't fit the white or the black or the Indian box, but can do several things. Mm-hmm. It's a real fear of diversity, I think, and being a polymath in this industry. We don't like those people because they can do lots of things and take lots of jobs away from us. But that really hasn't been embraced or covered in any mainstream seminar or lecture that I know of, and I really, really love to be able to get into drama schools as part of a professional preparation unit for the things that we're talking about, so class, also any kind of race discrimination, and give these people tools to be able to, when they're out there, they know what kind of industry they're going into. They're not walking in with rose-coloured glasses, whether that's specifically for race or class. That's something that I'd be really interested in doing. So if we can pull those facts together, I think it would be really helpful.
Dave, do you have a quick cheat sheet anywhere?
Yeah, so we can sort of send you that stuff. But also, I'm now part of a project with Create London and Arts Emergency, and one of the things that project is funded to do is create basically a kind of two-page set of infographics that, because we know nobody reads our 9,000-word academic papers. We sort of know that. That is like something that, you know, we're working on at the moment, so... Just, yeah, I mean, tweet me or...
And you sat very, very close to the member of staff at Equity, who'll be able to give you a lot of resources.
Yeah, so I'm going to hand over to Joe, and then I'll give everyone a minute to give us their two things that they think we can do.
Yeah, hello, everyone.
the one of the equality and diversity organisers at Equity. We've organised this Playfest season of events here. There's several things that I could comment on related to the discussion, and it's been great, the question's been great, but I'm just going to bang out a few things at you so that you know what we're doing. In terms of inclusive casting, it came up before about working class children looking at theatre, looking at TV, and how that affects them when they don't see people like themselves, when they see stereotypes. One of the things that we're doing, sort of alongside the work that Emmanuel does, is we're talking to employers. We've got an inclusive casting policy which encourages incidental casting, which is where the casting isn't about who you are. It's not about stereotyping. It's about being more diverse in writing, in stories, and so that there are people on stage and screen that younger people can look to and can aspire to, and that members who are working and actors who are working in the industry now are not treated in that stereotypical patronising way. So that the inclusive casting policy and incidental casting is a really big push of what we're doing at the minute. The committees, I'll take your point, we do have a deaf and disabled members committee, minority ethnic members committee, women's committee, LGBT plus committee, but they do, a lot of those are working class activists and they do talk about class issues. I'll take your point, it maybe can be embedded a bit more, and those committees are actually talking to each other more. We've actually set up just recently a formal process for those members to talk to each other. They are also having elections this year, so I'm going to just flag that for any members who might be interested in getting involved in these issues. But a lot of the work we're doing is about pushing portrayal, and we've got the BBC just recently also to include in their commissioning guidelines a section on casting, which none of the broadcasters have done. They will talk about their quotas, they will talk about their successes, like Channel 4 did last week. They're very happy to do that, but you know, they're still not addressing where there's a lack and where there are gaps and where we're still not seeing that representation on the screen. So we're doing quite a lot of work around content and around encouraging news stories and access into the industry for people who are still not represented properly. So I just wanted to flag that. And if you have any other general questions about equity, equality and diversity work alongside what Emmanuel does, please do get in touch with us. Thank you.
Would you like to do a quick sum up? One or two things that you think we can all do to kind of take this discussion forward so it's not just a talking shop?
Yes. Yes, I do.
You've got a minute, go.
I've got a minute. Back to your point, to Workers Equity or whatever, I think we shouldn't be waiting for anyone, or we shouldn't have need of approval to do something. I think we should do it ourselves. This need of keeping our schools or keeping our theatres accountable should be happening by ourselves. Jeremy Corbyn tweeted, if you are neutral in situations of injustice, you have chosen the side of the oppressor. We must speak up. We must be able to ask our schools, our theatres, and say, why? Why are all the members white? Why are all the members from a certain class? What is happening? What can we do to make it better and fairer for everyone? A while ago, I spoke to this young girl, because what I do sometimes is I speak to people about Central, and I try to persuade them to come to Central or to even apply, at least to apply, to know that there is a place for them, to even consider it. And she said to me, I don't want to apply. And I said, why? Why do you want to apply? I said, I cannot be a revolution everywhere I go. And that just, to me, just summed up, just, I mean, I know I'm supposed to be finishing on a happy note, but that just summed up how tiresome it can just be sometimes. That all I want to be, and I think about this sometimes, all I want to be is just a student. Not a black student, not you know, a black playwright. I just want to be a student and learn as much as you or as much as anyone, you know, and that is what I want to do. And sometimes people forget that at Central or other drama schools. Sometimes you start to fight, sometimes you start to, you know, have all these things. But yeah, I just realised the tiresome and the fatigueness of her, you know, this whole fight and this whole energy that's just going. And I just want to be a student.
Thank you. Manuel?
Value yourself. I mean, it sounds easy, but every time you make these decisions about the, you know, what work you take, what you're going to pay for, what you're not going to, what fees you're going to pay, you're essentially putting a value on what you do and on yourself. Don't allow other people to determine that and beat it down, right? Because that is what will always, what employers will always try to do in the big picture. You have to be proud of what you do and be confident in yourself. My second bit of advice is join Equity. I'm saying that not because I'm on commission, we're doing fine for numbers. I'm saying it because the only way that you can, in these very vulnerable positions you find yourself in, be able to get change and do it safely is from within a collective. I mean, that is the whole point of trade unions, that every one of you on your own is really quite vulnerable in an industry where, as we've heard, there is such a pressure, so many people prepared to take the work if you won't, etc., etc. But by sticking together, and you know, you've heard about so much good stuff that is being done, that is all happening because people are coming together like that, and that is you'd be amazed at how strong you are when you all stand together and how much we can achieve.
So. Thank you. Tom?
Firstly, join Actual Awareness in terms of we can help. We don't use Spotlight, we don't use Casting Corpora, we don't use any casting sites that you have to pay for. We release all our castings and writing submissions on Facebook and Twitter because it's accessible to everyone. And no matter where you're from, background, race, gender, it's all there. You can all access Twitter and Facebook. That's the way we kind of use it. We've got a documentary coming out called The Acting Class, which is very relatable. It's all about showing the struggles of working class actors and talent in the industry. Dave's in it. it's about showing the picture of, and we want to go into drama schools and we want to show this to them and say, this is what's happening. We've been filming it for over a year and a half now. So we've got a lot of interviews. We've got Maxine Peake in it, Christopher Eccleston. We've got people going through the drama school struggle. We've got people before drama school, after drama school. We've got all that. So that's happening as well. And we've got the film nights happening soon as well in Spotlight, which is short 15-minute films are going to be shown in the cinema, basically, which is brilliant. And secondly, I think drama schools just need to be tackled.
Yeah.
Full stop.
Great. Thank you. Dave, finally, very quickly. Sorry.
You guys, as part of the industry, are much more knowledgeable than certainly me, but also kind of man or woman in the street. And in some ways, that means you've got like this kind of terrible responsibility of being sort of ethical audiences and ethical consumers, raising awareness of bad practice and maybe, you know, not going to things that aren't paid or whatever. But also, I think you've got the opportunity to tell a story that actually is quite positive. You know, these kinds of discussions weren't happening 5 or 10 years ago. They are happening now. Equally, the sorts of, I guess, kind of roots in the 60s, 70s and 80s that we sometimes see as a kind of golden age. Actually, those eras were quite grim, particularly in terms of the intersections of gender and race with social class. So, you know, it's not a golden age. You know, it's not a kind of like, you know, glorious, good time to be alive, particularly politically, but equally things are better than they were, and you know, things are getting better. So although you've got, you know, this annoying kind of responsibility being knowledgeable about these issues in the industry, also things are changing.
Great. Thank you all so much for coming. We've run out of time now, so thank you very much. Contact me on Twitter, on Facebook. My details are public, so please keep in touch and join your equity branches as well. Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.